As I look across the waters here of our homelands, I think about treaty making and what that means to myself and what it could mean to you as you come here to visit me. So I want to share a little bit about what I know and what I've come to know about the 1850 treaty. I look at the hills over in the distance, the mountain range, and the vast amount of resources that are there. And prior to the 1850 Robinson Huron Treaty, and in two particular locations on the north shore of Lake Huron and the east shore of Lake Superior, the Anishinaabe leadership began to express their concerns with the mining activity that was taking place without their authorization, without their approval. So in this one instance, a group of leaders gathered together and put their canoe in the water along with a cannon that was left over from the War of 1812 that they still had. They paddled up the shores of Lake Superior to Mica Bay and demanded that the miners that were mining copper in that area demanded that they leave, because they didn't have authorization. And so the mining company did leave, but they went and told the Upper Canada government at the time that the Anishinaabe peoples evicted them and told them to leave, that they didn't have approval for mining in the area. And what the government ended up doing was they sent a group of individuals who began traveling the north shore of Lake Huron and talked to each of the Anishinaabe communities about what their territory was, if they were interested in developing a treaty. And within this report that was given back to the government, they provided the authorization to enter into treaty discussions with the Anishinaabe peoples. And this is how they had become to gather at the meeting place identified at Baoting, or what we now know as Sault Ste. Marie. So when the leaders gathered in Baoting in September of 1850, they had a good understanding of what they were looking for from the government, because it was the government that was asking for a treaty to be made so that they can allow for mining activity, timber harvesting. And part of the terms that they agreed to was that the Anishinaabe peoples would reserve their own lands to protect them as they were, without interference from the government. They wished to put these terms forward because of their discussions with other leaders across the territory. The Royal Proclamation of 1763 outlined a process of when and how treaty was to be made, and it had to be at a public meeting, there had to be consent, and only with the Crown could these agreements be made. The 1850 gathering specifically demanded terms that they wished to reserve lands for themselves, and they also wished for a share of any resource benefits in the form of an annuity that was to be increased from time to time. They also wanted to preserve their fishing and hunting rights throughout the territory. And the 1850 treaty, as it was agreed to, did not eliminate or cede or surrender any Anishinaabe rights to the treaty territory. So as I sit here sharing with you my understanding of the Robinson-Huron Treaty, I think about the hope of our people that our understanding will also be understood by federal and provincial governments, who are representatives of the Crown, who agreed to this treaty. And all we're asking for is our continued use and access of the lands, and to continue to protect them for all of our future generations.